And we're back. Game number three of this best of three. The final game of the day of the final series of the day. Empire against VP in this wonderful, wonderful new patch. It's all amazing. It's beautiful. The draft has begun. And Virtus Pro against Team Empire. The draft is well underway. As I can get myself into the game and unmute my co-caster, Trent. It's a warlock. It's a first pick. It's a new hero. And it's wonderful.
Everyone in chat just sitting there and praying. They're not even thinking about other heroes in the game. They're not thinking about the next picks. They're not thinking about the bans. They're thinking about nothing else other than, will this warlock get to level 20? I assume. Because that's all I'm thinking. It's very unlikely, percentage-wise. You know, not exactly a common occurrence. But if it does, we'll get that glorious new talent.
But if it does,
which if you guys have not seen, is a magical golem spawned upon his death, which is pretty great. Now, I assume it doesn't do the.
It does do the
any
stun.
Of it. It does.
Apparently, it does. From what I read, I've not tested it myself, so I'm kind of relying on.
To be fair, the spell itself says summons a golem from the death, comma stunning enemies for 1 second. Therefore, implying that the summon itself is what does it. It's not an additional factor to the summon. So by that logic, if you go by Magic the Gathering card reading logic, one would think that it does in fact stun. That would be my way to go about it. So there you go. Ogre Magi, good hero, worked out last game.
Clockwork first ban by VP this time, removing one of those long range initiation heroes from the hands of Empire.
I guess one guy we didn't talk so much about is Monkey King. Seems to, I believe it was Skim who first tweeted it, sold enough Arcanas, guys. No more bashes. Feels bad.
Time to buff Kunkka.
Yep. Time to turn up everybody else. Get ready for those Arcanas.
Get ready for the Immortals and the Arcanas and all that stuff from the compendium. Mm-mm.
So... yeah, Basher not having Monkey King. Earth Spirit, of course, is another hero that's been not necessarily having anything to do with this patch, but just recently with a lot of his changes, teams not finding the same value in him, especially as the early roaming for, more so a kind of mid-game team fighter. But if there's anyone that makes him work, it would be a Warlock. So we don't want to count out Earth Spirit quite yet just because of the Fatal Bond synergy and whatnot. But yeah, this is a very different looking game than the rest today, as we will have a Terrorblade very early on, not going to get banned out in the second phase, and we get a lovely Ghostic Nature's Prophet, and I do quite love this hero. 10 seconds,
really? Yeah, I mean, even before this patch, he was playing it relatively often, you know, going for the old phase boots, drums, Hand of Midas, Orchid kind of nonsense build, sometimes the Aghanims, but with this now, was a level 25, zero cooldown on TP. Not bad. Not bad at all.
I actually didn't. Sorry, I was going to say, I actually didn't read the change to Treant, did you? Nature's Guise now applies a full disarming root rather than a bash on attack.
Oh, what?
Oh, sorry, I missed that one, guys.
Cool.
Interesting.
Did TB have any big changes? I don't feel like Terrorblade got touched.
No, I don't think so.
Movement speed loss increased from 25 to 30.
So, not a very big touch at all. It's kind of surprising. He's also, I like that, the little question mark. He's also affected by the general illusion damage reduction against buildings. Thanks, Valve.
Just
a nice little note to put in.
Just to make sure you know that we really did screw up illusions again.
Yeah, make sure you're paying attention here. Yes, don't complain. We did do some other stuff to him. Chill out.
Yeah, calm down. Oh, Empire remove out Ember Spirit and Centaur. Well, VP, OD, and Sniper getting rid of some of FN's heroes.
Who's missing, though? I mean, compared to last game, remember, those VP bans, or rather, Empire bans against VP second phase, Chen and Enchantress. Hmm. Now, notably still in the pool, and Ogre Magi, not a great support with dealing with them. Yes, he can stand up to a neutral early on in the game, that's true. However, he certainly doesn't clear them. You could argue that Nature's Prophet, in a sense, does well against those sorts of heroes because he can split push while they try and group up with these heroes, but... still an option for sure if Lil wants to pursue it.
Disruptor, Nature's Prophet, global power, the ability to just drag on these team fights. You know, the kind of CIS classic. You TP in, you make up the numbers, you glimpse people back, you get the extra picks. It's definitely a kind of pick and play draft by Empire so far. While VP are like ramping up to some kind of heavy five man with a Terrorblade.
Or at least keeping that option open for sure. That's one of the better things about this opener. You don't have to commit fully with a Terrorblade these days or anything like that. You know, he doesn't have to end the game super early, but he always has that option. You know, him, Lycan, Troll, they are the three building punishers. And speaking of which, Lycan also still in could possibly come out here, but we'll find out if Disruptor will go 3 for 3. You know, he took them all so far. In fact, it will be his fourth win of the day, because Empire won that game with him, game 2 versus NIP.
What do they look for now, though? Mid-hero picking now is kind of scary against Nightstalker and Warlock, not knowing who you are up against. Like, usually you kind of mirror what your opponent does. Like, they've picked their safe lane one role, so you know what a kind of grand scheme plan is. Something maybe that can clear through Terrorblade Illusions.
I'd be looking at the kind of pressure. So we know that VP have a couple options in terms of pressuring the safe lane, so I don't think you'd want to go something like a Spectre or anything like that, despite the hero being pretty strong. Number one, I mean, it gets countered pretty hard against like Terrorblade and stuff. Did get nerfed pretty heavily with the Haunt thing, but just any of those weaker heroes are going to have to deal with either a Warlock Templar plus one or a Nightstalker plus one. And I actually think that makes sense to take your mid, because honestly, I think the one is way more questionable right now. I don't think you really know exactly how much pressure is going to be there or exactly what you need from that role. Plus, of course, we talked a lot about TA. She seems like she's going to be exceptionally strong with Ancients coming back to every 1 minute spawn, as well as every other camp, getting all these stacks and her not having to worry about cloak auras.
And with extra creep mid lane to splash off your side blades, extra damage, you know, for the denies, which give more experience and things like that. But Batrider for Virtus Pro, is that going to be a Pasha hero?
I mean, I believe so.
No one, I don't think, has ever really played these kind of playmaking mid, you know, Batrider and stuff like that. He's always been the kind of carry, farming, greedy mid player from what we've seen historically.
Definitely buffed again, right? This is a hero that uses all AoE. Yes, it's magic, but the damage itself isn't really a question for Batrider. He doesn't really get slowed down just because of the duration of Firefly and with the napalm stacks. It just means you sack a couple more on or whatever, right? So he should be very strong this patch. Should certainly have quite a bit more damage to throw onto these neutrals. Yeah, exactly. Just more stacks, more money. Should be faster. Blink daggers. And with the help of a Nightstalker too, we're going to have that increased vision, helping with the lassos. You know, we often see Nightstalker plus Disruptor to increase the glimpse range. Now we just have the exact same thing here with Nightstalker plus Batrider. And
what are you scared of from a one roll here as VP?
What would I ban?
I don't feel there are any heroes that, you know, scream out, oh god, we do not want to be up against this.
Yeah, I would think, like, what are the strong ones left? Ursa's in the pool, but it's a Terrorblade. He doesn't have any clear. He doesn't do too well against Batrider. They have a Templar, which kind of does a lot of the same things as Ursa, so it would be very all-in to do something like that. So he's not really a concern. The Lifestealer is still in the pool. He's good against the Batrider. Maybe the Slark is probably the ban, actually.
I think Slark. I was going to say Lifestealer's not very good against TB in the mid-game.
No,
gets kited very heavily, whereas Slark has some maneuverability to get away from the Metamorphosis Beast.
Still would have been, like, he's good against Bat, but he still suffers a lot of the same things that, like, the Ursa does, in the sense that, like, him and TA kind of do the same thing. Like, they come online around the same time, and maybe it pigeons you a little bit into a super strong point, and then, like, this valley, but then they still do okay in the later stages, too, of course. It's just maybe it can be hard to grab that momentum if you don't get a bunch of kills. But who's left? They still have Jug in terms of anti-Batrider heroes, but again, you know, TB, not the funnest thing, but at least you could build, like, Mjolnir or something.
I wonder if they'll go for...
Clung. Clink seems kind of bad.
Like, you can't pick Meepo for Chappie here against Fatal Bonds and Firefly and Sticky Napalm. It's incredibly difficult to play up against those things.
I don't know enough about Arc Warden to say that's a good Arc Warden game.
See, that's what I was going to come up to next, because I don't either. Arc Warden is this kind of, you know, weird ethereal creature that is picked by Empire and OG, and no one quite understands what it does or how it does it. It didn't have a very good win rate at Kiev. It was like, you know, one game out of nine or something like that. You know, it was ridiculously bad.
Anyway,
but I don't think it does too well against TB anyway.
VP, maybe considering their Venno mid, perhaps. I mean, there's a TA. You already have a lot of damage from the TB. Helps in pushing. Helps with Nightstalker in early fights.
That could be nifty. It's time to bring back Viper, though, I'm sure.
Is that a hero yet? I don't know if that's a hero yet.
It's really not.
People can keep hoping. This would be a kind of cool game to do the mid Jakiro.
Oh, yeah. Ursa Warrior. I go for the Ursa.
Oh, that's very VP.
Okay. Not sure about the matchup against TA. I guess it does okay, because you can place yourself past your creep wave and in the middle of the enemy creep wave and not get splashed to death, like so many other ranged heroes do. It gives you that kind of tempo that you need to play with the bat, with the Night Stalker. Once Warlock hits six, and once TB gets up and running into these two.
Surely going to be some sort of a 2v2 or something anyway, I'm sure.
Yeah. Maybe Warlock Ursa.
It is the there he is. All right.
Apparently.
I sensed it. I don't know why, but I was like, I think it's coming.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I would think with the Ursa, that helps though, right? This is a jump on you, burst kind of a hero. He has to get inside the little bubble now, of course. You know, not too much of a problem for melee heroes, so Ursa's slightly okay with that, but pretty bad for a Terrorblade. It's going to be hard for them to push super early on. Batrider and Nightstalker give a lot of map pressure and vision, though, in terms of catching out this Arc Warden. But again, that doesn't really come to play in the later stages because of the whole clone thing. What a weird hero.
And Ghost Stick with this Nature's Prophet won't be allowed, or won't be able to apply as much damage to the safe lane as maybe other lanes he'd be up against. Because you know, so often we see now the Brown Boots into Phase Boots Nature's Prophet just right-clicking people, but against the TB with so much armor, and maybe with a poor man's shield, and with his solo Warlock behind him healing him up, maybe Team Empire even run a dual lane of their own up a top lane. Nature's Prophet plus Ogre, leave Arc Warden alone with Disruptor. I feel like this game might just be that natural 1v1 mid.
We'll have to find out. A rare occurrence. Oh man, that is a sexy looking Nature's Prophet. I gotta get me that beard. What a man.
Can you grow a beard in real life, Trent?
No, I really can't. If I want to do Movember, I would have to start now. That's pretty much my status. You know, my brother has a beard, my dad has a beard.
How old are you?
Oh, I'm just a 26-year-old manlet. Don't worry about me.
That's so sad.
Look at that Nature's Prophet beard. Oh, God, he's just taunting it.
Where is he?
Oh. He's smoked, but you can still see shades of its glory.
Very nice. What's it called?
Everyone go to Steam Market here. That's the beard of the Trubark adherent. With a lovely Russian dedication.
Beautiful. Solo already forced to heal up. Didn't get an Observer Ward down because Meposhka was ready. Guarding the door.
Should get some kickbacks from Valve, you know?
Yeah.
Honestly.
Oh dear, I had to restart my game so all my console shit is gone. Whoops. Oh well.
Disc.
Life goes on. I guess.
I guess.
I mean, I'm not alt-tabbing at this point. It's over. It's like, it's not happening. It's not happening. So, game number three. 1-1. Every time I try to do any kind of introduction, people start spamming the crash and burn and charge and frog and all that crap. Right. Ghost Stick, Nature's Prophet going to be heading up towards the top lane alone, it looks like. FN the mid TA, of course, while Ramsey's in solo, TB and Warlock. Everything's normal. Lil has an Iron Talon on his Night Stalker, so he'll be farming the jungle. I wonder if he'll start making maybe one stack for Pasha for a little bit later on, because that Batrider will need at least a stack or two to get close to that Blink Dagger, while no one's Ursa heading mid lane. Facing up against the TA. Chappie's Arc Warden, of course, down at bot with the help of Solo. King R on the Disruptor. Every time I see Disruptor, I think Solo. Like, that's
I mean,
how.
That's fair.
That's like how hard coded Disruptor plus Solo is in. Like, even back on Vega Squadron, like, right? You know? Yep. It's his hero. It's definitely his hero.
Him and Xioma, I guess.
It feels so weird. Four melee creeps mid lane. But this is how Ursa plays. He goes past his creep wave, doesn't get Psy Splash, applies some debuff there to FN with a Fury Swipes. That's a lot of damage. So a lot of damage. Get some last hits. He'll be able to take that and deny his range creep. Oh yes, hello. Free experience. And now I'm, you know, a quarter of a level ahead of you with one deny. Beautiful stuff out from him already. Down a bot lane, Pasha TPing away, barely escapes by the skin of his teeth. The Batrider survives the three-man movement in with all their damage, but a limited lockdown as the glimpse was already used. Of course, Ignite from the Ogre has no stun.
Ghost Stick just kind of doing his thing up here, though. Feels all right, you know? Aha! Take these... Man, Treants do so much damage early. Oh, two armor, not enough. This guy is just the shadow buffs, man. If it's stacking up an Aegis Prop for so long, it feels like Bulldog just... He murdered this hero that slowly over time, Ice Frog is very hesitant to give him anything.
It's that global power, you know, all of these heroes with global abilities. Meposhka might die here. No one. Going in for the kill, the clap will miss, and now he's up against FN. The body blocks come through, the damage doesn't look like it'll be enough to finish him off, though. No one will have to salve himself up, but still has to be careful about Psyblade splashes cancelling it out. Got his boots now as well, but that was close to First Blood going the way of the Ursa in this 1v2 lane. That's how difficult it is to lane up against the Ursa mid nowadays.
Yeah, and look where Lil is. Doop-de-doo. Don't mind me just iron toweling the jungle, running all the way back to Fountain, because shrines, lol. Certainly a blast from the past, right? We used to see this iron talent all the time for position 4 Night Stalkers. Get level 4 by 4 minutes, start rotating. We'll see if Lil can come close to that mark.
That's a nice combo. It's a very nice combo with a Spark, Wraith, and Kinetic Field comboing up. Masha drops low and dies. And that Flux. It's often difficult to kind of gauge how much damage you're going to be taking, but if you don't get back to some allies quickly, you start ticking down lower and lower while Ghostic top lane
is getting
just like
tagged.
Oh god,
he just got like 3. That was really rough.
And that's all from that one movement from Ogre. You know, previously no one was playing aggressively past his creep wave, applying damage to FN.
TP coming in.
But FN now going in onto no one. The TP from Ghostic comes on through. The Fairy Fire is there though, and no one looks like he should be just fine to walk it all off. VP seem out of sorts.
They kind of do. Again, I like what you're saying about the Arc Warden as well, though. Because, you know, the things we do know, this guy, he's kind of weird in terms of the lane, right? He can put a ton of damage, he just needs the right setups, and that Kinetic Field does a wonderful job. Now going in, but again, Kinetic Field. Chavi can just play this how he wants.
Pasha's dead here. With the Flux on him and the right clicks from Kingar. Well. Top lane, Ghostic. Walks into a metamorphosized, the Terrorblade with big wings!
Can't fly though, he's not a nice soccer quite yet.
Look at how sick that Arcana is though.
He's a Death Eater, man. That guy's scary.
Oh, it inscribed Marauder's Demon Form. There's another item. I didn't know that item existed, to be fair.
He's spooky.
He has the Arcana and he has a Demon Form item. Cool. I'm gonna look for that on the I'm legit gonna look for that on the market when I go home.
Valve, you're welcome.
Pro game selling items since 2011. 2012, whatever the hell it was.
Alright, so 3.25 at 4 minutes, not bad. I mean, honestly, it was pretty hard to get level 4 minutes, and the 20% decrease means it's gonna be even harder these days. You have to get, like, the exact right camps for that to work out well. And it was when Iron Town was better.
It's going to be annoying relearning like fast Midas timings as well now. It's got the extra 100 gold to pop up on that recipe. You know, Chappie's getting closer and closer to 1400.
Can they
so.
Kill here? He has a TP. He could go for it right now. He would have lived. Oh, he's still fine.
Boska's still perfectly fine. Flamebreak doesn't cancel TPs, so he just gets out. And that's a bat plus a Nightstalker roaming through the jungle looking for the TA. They find a stack here. Unfortunately,
oh, mana.
It's a 1-1-1 build from Pasha, so they don't have a lot of damage. He's going to start stacking up Napalm on this.
Yeah, you can do it, though.
Is it worth it, though? It's a one
Denying that from a TA, that's got to be worth it.
Yeah, I guess so.
Like, they haven't worn Leper Ancients, though. That is one thing.
4 Napalm stacks and a Firefly does damage. Meposhka comes in to leech some XP. Literally just standing next to them. Nothing they can do about it. Can't kill him. Can't zone him. Can't harass him. I've said that, but I might have lied. Because Solo's arrived.
Warlock,
I don't know, I just see...
He just walked in.
Solo just like wanders in like, hello, I am a Warlock. Level 2 Shadow Word, apparently enough. I mean, TB's fine up on top lane. Ghostic has left the lane. Fair enough.
Okay, I mean, I'm sure that's still worth for Ogre. You get all that experience and it takes 4 heroes essentially in this quadrant of the map. Probably okay with that result. Your TA safely jungling away, knowing where everyone is.
And the shrines.
And look at this top. No pressure on this tower. That is actually crazy. 6 minutes in and a largely alone Ramzes. Ooh, with the stack though. That's going to be a very happy metamorphosis next, I would reckon.
Oh, yeah.
Or Batrider, perhaps, I suppose. They want to get Pasha upped up. But back to Arkborn. This hero, you know, we know he has the magic damage, right? Because we saw Kuro, I believe, play at support a couple times too. So, generally, you know, those kind of heroes, they have some significant magic damage to help out with levels too. Now gone on though.
Glimpse back. Firefly still there as Lil chases him down. The Kinetic Field though, Chappie turns to fight with a TP from Ghostic coming in to get some experience and gold for himself. There's another Spark Wraith down. It looks like Pasha's just about managed to dodge that one out. King R applies a few more right clicks in, but the kinetic field actually trapping Pasha in. They've got no damage. No one's following through.
This looks like when Empire were trying to kill a bunch of times. Like when they were trying to get Ramsey over and over in that clinks, and they were just constant support rotations, always there in time, understanding when they want to put that pressure. And so the same reads now coming up from Empire. And they're just like, all right, look, they're going to try and go on our court, just like chill nearby, guys. And every single time, they're so close. And then the connect field comes out, and he just slowly turns around through the napalm and fires back. And that's a 7-minute Midas. He's gone Wraith Band, Midas, and he could not be happier.
That's the thing, you know, I was saying it's going to be difficult to gauge fast and slow Midas timings, but Lil goes in with a Void, runs himself away.
He's got mana for the glimpse now.
They do, with the kinetic field on top of it. Lil is actually dropping incredibly low. Do they have another spark? Wraith, he flies over the trees, but doesn't get far enough. Lil's just going to get chased and run down here in the death. Oh, Chappie dies.
Clone.
Well, it's a clone. Never mind. JK.
Got him.
Yeah, you got me. You tricked me. But yeah, you know, Chappie was kind of consistently getting pre-8-minute Midases in the previous patch.
Yep.
And,
still got it.
You know, 6.5 minutes Midas was very fast in the previous patch, but getting one just as quick, or, you know, 7.5 minutes or whatever in this patch, where there's 100 gold more, very, very good.
Yeah, those four assists kind of helped. Maybe a little. Not too shabby.
Just a touch. Just a touch.
A wee bit there. Ramsey's, has he actually hit this tower now? A little bit. Get some pressure on there, but still a full minute away from the next metamorphosis. And Pasha looking relatively low and out of mana, so he did clear out that camp. But all he has is a Windlace to show for it. Only 28 last hits at 8.5 minutes. Pretty poor Batrider, but only 400 behind a Nature's Prophet.
Empire is slamming this early laning stage.
Experience
wise,
they're going to continue so top
gold
two.
Gold wise, kill on TV wise, and in they go.
That's Thunder.
He does, but can he turn and throw it onto anyone? Look at them, look at them. They just turn, they turn. They run away. They've got the damage from range. They're looking for more.
The kinetic field
division.
Of the Treants. He was just stuck. He couldn't go anywhere. They just beat him to death. A bloody pulp.
This is scary for VP. Lil is doing okay. He farmed jungle and he's made a couple of decent, you know, rotations, but 5-1 at 10 minutes in when your Batrider is nowhere near blink. Sure enough, he's got the kind of small, you know, little incremental items, the tranquils, the raindrop, the magic wand, but he's nowhere near level 6 either. No stacks for him. There's nothing for him to fall back onto, and Ramses has taken over this dire jungle. Chappie's farming away like a madman.
Well, no one's got to be the hero that we're looking at then, right? Has to get a blink dagger. I'm trying to accelerate this game. Him and the Batrider working in tandem. If they can pressure with nature, or rather, pressure with the Terrorblade, and then focus the attention there from Empire. Like, if you don't bring all five, you're just gonna get lassoed and jumped, and we're gonna try and use that nighttime to our advantage. So 2 minutes until that starts, and that's gotta be the full focal point for VP. You know.
That was a good scan from VP, looking behind the Arc Warden to see if there's anyone there, because they're grouped up to try and kill him, but he TP's mid to look for no one. He goes for a TP of his own, but the Meposhka stun, the Fire Blast, stops the Ursa from retreating. And again, all of these heroes from Empire appear from the woodwork as if by magic. Ghostic TPs, Chappie TPs. And the Ursa thought he was in a 1v1 against the Disruptor, which he was, you know, pretty happy with. And all of a sudden, there's four heroes shoving spells down his throat.
And what great use by Ghostic too. He missed one block so far this game where he came in on that Ursa and wasn't able to like get the call over there or anything, block him off, but obviously that was very early. Good game. Oops, wrong one from FN.
Sorry, please. Yeah. Oh, dearie me. He's trying to use his chat wheel memes, but sometimes do not come out with what you intended. Top lane, catapult wave. Tier 1's dropping low. The glyph is forced, but Metamorphosis should be able to secure this. I don't think Ghostic will have enough to come and stop this from happening. Maybe with the rest of his team following through. Chappie, King R. Static Storm's ready. Now, Tier 1's already dying and Solo is, you know, faking out that golem drop.
Dropping the base. Yeah, I gotta say, you know, everyone always props up Liquid, especially Matoma Man, the way that they use like summons and stuff, revision, everything. Ghostic kind of doing a lot of the same stuff, plus this whole draft, right? They're making use of this double vision essentially to help out their disruptor. It's not the most common heroes to do it, but TPing forward to give glimpse, just Treants running up high grounds to give glimpse, and then these fluxes to kind of like scout targets and whatnot. It's pretty clever. Spark rates, of course. clever stuff.
It really is. So VP have, you know, VP have a couple of options here. They're 1,400 net worth behind. It's not a massive amount by any means at 12 minutes. Nope. The levels, they are a little bit lacking, you know. The kind of net worth on their cores is definitely visibly lower than their opponents. So now it's nighttime. Do you go for a smoke play? You have Warlock Golem? Yes, you do. Illusion. You go for some kind of kill. The other option would be, you know, to kind of sit back and farm passively in your jungle, but with it being so congested with five heroes in the two jungle areas, two of which, the Batrider and TB, who desperately need these items, it's much more reliable to go for some kind of kill play. No one, phase boots and windlace, try and find someone, pick and play.
We knew this was the play, though. I mean, we said it 2 minutes ago. This is what they're going to do. It's very telegraphed. It's a Night Stalker. They're not ready to rotate here on the region. Time the golem.
TA gets obliterated. They TP and Ghost Stick looking for a glimpse back onto Solo, and they'll find it. Solo trapped inside the field. And down he goes. The Warlock Golem looks like it's going to survive. They even... Urn and Thunderstrike on the Golem. He's got 25 HP regen though, so it looks like he's okay. A bit of a waste of an Urn charge, but okay. But this has given no one his Blink Dagger. That is the big trigger item now for VP to start making bigger plays.
Yeah, they want to use that to try and get to the Blink Dagger for Pasha, I'm sure. But, I mean, that's for Timebot, though. You knew that was coming from the Dire. And they're going to try to do the same thing here from the Radiant, but they run into Lil before they run into Ramses.
Yeah. Lil's Nightstalker, you can't fly over the field. It's too high, the wall has been built. And in comes the Metamorphosis from TB. Static Storm's dropped, and Miposhka will also fall. King R, oh, no one, hello, there's the Blink reveal. The upheaval slows them all down. Chappie dropping lower and lower, two more swipes. He's inside the Magnetic Field, so it's just one more hit, and down he goes with a lasso back. This is VP hitting their stride. They've got a 2-for-4 exchange. If they can just finish off Ghost Stick, get into the trees, find the kill, the TP's cancelled out. By the final swipe of no one, as death is brought to the Nature's Prophet.
That should be his Blink now as well, right? Yeah, only 100 gold away. So VP are indeed quite ready, and this gives them full control over the Roshan pit. 2 minutes until daytime, plus they have the ultimate available from Lil. They should be able to clean that up, I would think, before daytime returns here. And this is all still before FN has that first coveted item on a Templar Assassin. This game, it will be the Deso before the Blink Dagger or anything, so slightly delayed before joining fights. And then, of course, that means much less likely to contest Roshan itself.
It's still kind of scary being a Templar Assassin up against a TA and a TB. You don't have real, you know, good, consistent ways to deal with the illusions. And with an Urs just popping Enrage in your face, you don't have a Hurricane Pike, you don't have any save mechanisms. You know, there's no way to get a TA out of a fight once she's entered it, apart from maybe sprouting her and trying to TP away.
Yeah. Although, I mean, there are still Arc Warden shenanigans. Maybe that's something that could help. He has a finished Maelstrom too.
He does. Bottom tower Chappy. Is under
attack. Oh, and they're going to try and take it first with the Deso. I like this. This is a nice snag from Empire. Just having lost the fight, where are they looking from the Dire? They have Night Stalker scouting. They have this tower pushed in. No one's defending, and this is what they're thinking. They're like, okay, pressure with just the Night Stalker, see if we can force a rotation, but no one's coming.
The scan from the
and
Radiant.
It's nothing but an illusion.
Spots a TB illusion coming in, but Roshan's dead already. 15 minutes in, and that Deso from TA securing a massive objective there for Team Empire. Solo wards in front of that tier 2 mid lane.
That would have been such a difficult fight to take too. A TA with nothing but Deso up against Batrider and Nightstalker.
And upheaval.
Controlled by silences, yeah, an upheaval, level the ult, like everything was there.
Level 4 upheaval. Disgusting amounts of slows.
That's actually brutal, you missed that fight as VP. You were so geared up for that Roche fight. Like, unquestionable victory, you would think.
But you said
the mobility and everything.
You said at the start of this game that, you know, we saw a lot of good rotations in game number 1 from VP, reading Empire like a book almost, and it was an easy stomp. Then Empire come back in game 2, make a lot of the same, you know, similar reads, make sure that they get the game under control. The Chappie Razor was working well for them. And now one misread, one play where VP thought we'll find someone farming Radiant Jungle, maybe someone TPing in to defend the tier 1 bot lane, then get the tower. And they get none of it. They don't get the tower. They don't get a kill. They don't take the jungle. They get some wards down at the very least. But look at them.
Yeah,
they're like headless
smoked
chickens.
Up, running in circles.
Literally just running in circles. It looks like there'll be a go here onto Lil, but it's a jump in from no one. The last go out from the Batrider as well. There's the Meltrack and a big old chaotic offering. Static Storm is down, but it doesn't catch on to anyone with the upheaval, slowing the TA. VP, they're trying to chase down King R, but Pasha dragged back with the glimpse. The fight continues over on the side of FN, as his Aegis has popped. And with no Blink Dagger and a Sentry down, I don't think retreat is an option here. Lil Sunder from Ramses keeps his mate alive. The buddy system working out wonders for VP. Finally a team fight they can call their own. They bust out everything in the kitchen sink, though, to win that.
And that is the beauty of Warlock right there. Not concerned about heroes like Disruptor, who can, you know, we saw so many times Staxstorm come out to stop something like the Death Ward in the last game, or just, you know, everyone enclosing in onto the fight, but Warlock just way from the back lines, chucks that thing down, and the fight just seems insurmountable at that point. So VP, after struggling a little bit in terms of the identity of the map and where they need to be, they have figured it out now, but Lil, he's figured out by the Radiant, so...
How did they see him?
A Constellation kill. Was it probably an Arc Warden thing?
Yeah, I guess so. Must have been.
Just Arc Warden things, you know.
Amazing stuff. Absolutely amazing stuff. But that was meant to be the momentum shift, that, or the momentum sort of breaker there, was the Aegis on the TA. Supposed to win team fights with that, not lose one straight after. And now VP feeling very strong. TB with a Dragonlance Yasha, nearly up on his Manta style. No one's Ursa has been a sight to behold in this game. 2-1 and 4, not too many kills, but he's been in the right places at the right time to get those big juicy targets like the Templar Assassin.
Alright, Govsek, he does have himself a Chateau Blade, so he's gonna have this game.
He's very
good. Like Orchid or something. Orchid's kind of meh. Well, it's okay against Ursa.
He could go for the Maelstrom route. But I don't know if you want to, like, I don't know if you want to overlap with what Arc Warden does.
Exact same item build.
Yeah. I mean, it's Master identical. It's identical, right?
Yes, well played indeed, Chappy. So they will finally get that pressure on the bottom lane and with an Aegis Prophet. Long ago, top lane has gone down, so it's not like there's any sort of a trade happening for the Radiant. Although they will start to position and posture around top. I've been patiently waiting for some ancients to reappear. And BKB almost done for no one, so... Blink BKB for him, Blink Deso for TA. Relatively evenly matched at this point. And how does the next fight kick off? It's gotta be around Golem, and it's just coming back up right now. So Radiant will be aware of this. They didn't pressure or force anything during that, and now it's nighttime. So perhaps a little bit of a window missed there for Empire if they want to get something done, but they have some items on their own, of course, that they're opting for, this Blink Dagger for the TA and stuff like that. So more so just a fortunate timing in a way for VP.
VP really do like these early BKBs, don't they? We saw them at Kiev, we saw them in this series. They, especially no one, likes to go for early BKBs for... A big reason that he likes to go into team fights early on and start battering people to pieces. It does leave them a little bit open-ended once the game drags on a little bit.
Pasha. This is an ogre, though. I don't know. Okay, that was a TA.
He's pinging them out, and now there's a disruptor. He doesn't see. Well, actually, he does with the Dire Observer Ward. They'll see the two supports moving north and the TA on the creep wave. People are coming in here from VP solo. No one in Lil. Are they gonna smoke? I don't
under that vision again.
One.
See these supports. We see TA.
They walk past the TA. They see him. Blink away from FN. Ogre.
Ace rune is so helpful right now, though.
He's been left alone, I think. Mephoshka's gone. And TA. TP's out.
If it wasn't for the massive cooldown, of course, I'm sure he would have went for a guess there solo, but not worth it. They even scanned to check, but she is long gone. Just grab himself the ogre, but it is posturing. Oh my goodness, that was a quick one from no one.
Yeah, even
Hops
through the glimpse.
On in.
The glimpse was there, but it was just too much damage. The final swipe lands.
It's gonna be this nice posturing.
Oh yeah, onto that tier two. Ghostick is aiming for the orchid. It's gonna be.
Makes sense.
What for though? For the warlock?
It's good against Ursa. Stops like even the Aghanims and stuff, right?
Yeah, I guess so. Well.
Yeah, he just died.
Well.
What a hero.
Okay.
Arc Warden. He doesn't even have bots. Like,
he just walks.
He pees it in.
He just
go to the shrine.
Fair enough. Okay. Batrider just gets obliterated.
TP tower. It's great. Good memes. But I like Lil's build this game. It's kind of cool, right? Vanguard. Interesting. I haven't really been paying much attention to what he's been up to, but super slow down on the Aghanims. That is one problem.
Is he going straight into the Crimson as well? He's picking up a Bracer or something. What's he doing? Why has he switched his Vanguard for his Gauntlet? Am I dumb?
Yeah, you're definitely not dumb. It must have been something with... Did he think that the Courier can only complete? It must be some sort of mistake. He just hasn't realized or something when he was switching items.
What's the Gauntlet for?
It's the...
Did you buy it by accident for the urn?
I don't know, maybe.
I feel like that's what's happened. I feel like he's bought the... hello, FN finds Lil. Lil finds FN. They find each other, but it's going to be a TP away by the Templar Assassin. Ash is still farming away. Full staff required.
It's like, why do I have this gauntlet? What's going on?
Why does he have this gauntlet?
Where'd my Vanguard go?
This gauntlet doesn't do anything.
I didn't catch if he was shrining or something. It just didn't move back, but either way.
No,
they will smoke up. No, I know what you're saying about the gauntlet, though. Yeah. It might have just been an early game item, and then you're just like, oh yeah, right, oops.
Oopsie, urn change recipe.
He was thinking drums, too. Like, drums aren't bad for his team.
I mean, it is first series of the patch, you know. That's his first time buying urn on this new patch. Oh, hello. Dire Vision. I think they see Maposhka. It's an ogre, but it's a kill.
Yeah.
If they can find him, if they can chase him, he's TPing away. They're not going to get him. They've gone for Ghost Stick instead. The Shadow Blade is there. There's no reveal from the Dire team. And away goes Ghost Stick. TPs away to safety while the Faithful Bonds and the Flame Break should be able to clear up these little old treants.
A bit of money for them, but Force Staff, finished, of course. It's only a 400 gold recipe now. Dota 2, Dota 3, call what you must. Happy day for a Bat Rider. And we start eyeing towards next Roche. Will be about a minute away here. And that's cheese. The second Roche now has cheese. If you guys have not tuned into the notes.
Second Roche cheese feels good, man. Chappie finds solo. This might be a quick and easy kill with the clone. Yeah, he is.
Nice global use there.
A secure from Ghost Stick, of course.
How much did that do?
350.
Wow. Yeah. That is crazy. And it's like free vision because it's just this clone.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. That's only level 2. Wow.
So that's your Orchid done for Ghost Stick now. And he's moving into a BKB. This might be the time for VP to move in onto Maposhka. But Ghost Stick sprouts up no one. Silences him with the Orchid as well. So the BKB is forced to pop. But FN has jumped in the lasso with a glimpse. No one's dropped, and Asha stuck here as well with a 2x multicast and the trap out, and he's demolished! The melt strike from FN just slaps it in his face.
Ghost Stick actually does so much damage too. Like, I mean, it's a TA, so it's a little bit overshadowed, but when she's throwing that decimal on top of people, and Ghost Stick is right clicking them, I mean, look at this guy. Like, 200 and some damage right now. Ain't too shabby.
I feel like Empire have this game on lock. Like, Arc Warden has been so slyly farming and moving around the map. He's got a full Mjolnir on top of his Shadow Blade. Boots of Travel is nearly here as well. They move into the Roche Pit for FN to come in with a Desolator hits. And VP are in no position to come and stop this, with Ursa dead for 13. TB having zero mana to his name, so he can't go and contest the Roshan either. It's an Aegis and a Cheese for free for Empire, almost. They're actually going to come in and try and fight this, but look at that. The Silence stops the... Stops the Warlock from getting in too deep. He did get the ult down, but so did the Disruptor. And look at that Static Storm blocking the path, blocking the entry. They can't get into the pit, and Roshan dropping. It's getting lower and lower. VP needs to get in, but the glimpse back onto no one will secure the Aegis for FN, as well as the cheese, I'm assuming, goes the way of Chappie.
Oh man, he was mid-Fatal Bonds cast too, so maybe he was like trying to get that turned around, but not enough there. Man, that first Roche, honestly.
Wait,
it was so important for this game.
Cheese went to Ghost Stick.
Oh, did it. Good choice.
Chappie's just gonna stand in Fountain now and send his clones around. He's got his boots to travel. AFK farm the jungle. But VP, again, they look almost unsure of what they're meant to be doing with themselves. Ramses has been farming, sure, he's got himself a decent amount of net worth, but then you look at the three heroes above him. Arc Warden, Nature's Prophet, and TA.
And I love this, honestly. Like, Ghostick pushes the lane to, like, here. And then it's just Mopushka. You know, he's, like, living in this zone down here. It's his little death zone, but it's, like, bait. You know, he just comes and hits the tower, like, okay, TB, I'll leave, I suppose. But other than that, yeah, they've killed him a couple times. Other times he just runs away, but he's getting quite a bit out of the map for being just an ogre. You know, he doesn't care. He's a Solar Crest. His life's done. What else does he have to achieve?
Gain experience and bait smoke ganks, I guess.
Pretty much.
VP, lots of scribbling on the map saying we've got to get here and here and here, but those are pretty difficult positions to take and hold. And as Chappie moves forward into the Dire Jungle with his Arc Warden, and TP's bot lane with his clone, Nighttime is popped, but Empire on the high ground near the shrine may be thinking it's about time to go for a tier 2 mid, maybe
good
high ground.
Good scouting with the Treants too.
Solo gets an Observer Ward down. They see everything that's happening. VP. They're walking into a death trap, it feels. King R drops the kinetic field, maybe with a good initiation from no one. The two supports, the static storms down. King R goes scepters and tries to survive. The TP out is not enough. That Satter Blast with the help of Lil's Void will take down the Disruptor. Did Ogre survive? Of course he did.
He just ran.
He's
an ogre.
Solar Crest.
He's got Solar Crest.
Okay, he just...
Six Fury Swipe stacks and he's only like 50% HP.
Just waddles away. And that's a Ramsey's Metamorphosis down without really anything gained. Empire switch down to bottom lane, look for the kill onto Solo with the clone. The Sunder is available from Ramsey's, but they're not going to use it. The clone
help
is going to die. Solo very, very close to death, though. So. Ghost against the tower with the Treants. This is all... coming up, Empire at this point. Chappie, though, boots of travel on cooldown.
Was Lil?
Very, very close. He dusts, but not in time to get the lasso. This is where Pasha needs that gem. He's got it in the quick buy slot.
Lil actually just bought it, too, because he got gold from that last fight. Mm. So he can, yeah, they were both kind of eyeing it up for a while, so he can actually hand it over at this point. Once he's done his dewarding rotation, but we did point out he has not purchased the Aghanims yet. So there are definitely some downsides to this Night Stalker this game.
Look, Lil runs at the ogre and then TP's coming.
Gem.
Chappie. The clone static charge over on the creep. No one clears it up without getting zapped. So irritating. VP have been corralled back into their own base.
Look at the damage it does. This clone. Do you see this?
Yeah, it's insane.
And that was like 4 seconds of hitting him. Jeez. This hero.
Empire.
Unexplored territory, honestly.
12,000 net worth lead over on Empire. A lot of this does belong to Chappie, but Ghostick is up there as well. He's got his full BKB done. Hex is on the horizon. Aegis lasts for another a minute and a half or so for FN. But they found King R. They've got the Disruptor. Not a huge kill, but this might be what VP needs to, you know, poke and prod a little bit, but you look at that one lane, you're like, okay, they got a kill. They've got a bit of map pressure. Then you look at the other lanes, there are four heroes mid, and then a clone. Oh, no, it's a one hero top, and then three heroes and a clone mid.
I was just looking, I was thinking like, yo, but Disruptor will be right back, but wait! Ladies and gentlemen, they're over. Aha! One goes down. Well, yeah, it's just, I don't know, they already have the objectives down there, so it's just so like, eh, he died. You know, we're still farming like crazy. Who cares? Just feels of like no consequence whatsoever. And there'll be a Lincoln Sphere down here soon for TA, so the one real concern from FN diving deep, be it Lasso or Sunder, is starting to be nullified. They have a couple ways to cancel it though, so they have to be a little bit wary. You know, like, Nightstalker's always ready essentially with both Void and Crippling Fear.
How does VP win this game?
Terror Blade. I've learned to never doubt this hero.
It is on the back of Terrorblade. It's going to be one fight with, you know, Fatal Bonds, Chaotic Offering, and a Metamorphosis. Hopefully for VP, it will be outside of Empire's base.
Yep. And they just...
What are they
take
marking
out, take
there?
Take a lane, basically.
Was that Glyph? What were they... Three people just marked a timer.
I think they just marked Roche expiring. They were just refreshing it.
Ah.
Yeah, so 3 minutes.
Okay.
Smart players.
I see. Yeah. This is where
that'll
VP are now.
Earliest possible spawn.
Up on the front lines, looking for something, looking for control around the Roche pit.
Accurate line from Ghostick, just pointing out where they were. He was correct. However, they have rotated through, so Just a little cautious here, FN. He has the blink, he has refractions up. Not too much concern being this close.
And a Lincoln's. Lincoln's BKB, so he can't be jumped by the Batrider, really. I'll go for this little guy instead. Disruptor. Caught and killed.
Now that's a bit different. That's a pickoff right at the feet. And it is the Disruptor, you know, that's a lot better than killing Ogre and Disruptor down here. Can they do anything with it, though?
Look at where their creep wave is, though. 30 seconds until King R is alive. And yeah, the TPs go back. Ramsey's just runs away.
I can't do anything. I actually can't. You know, top lane, maybe they can try and make some rotations up there. But then you're, like, bogged in by the shrine. That's a little bit scary. They can just come in from behind you. Already have to worry about the TP rotations of this ridiculous hero Arc Warden and the Nature's Prophet.
What's his next item? What's he got queued up? Silver Edge for Chappie, it looks like it's going to come through. That's going to be real dangerous for no one. Especially when you'll have a Bloodthorn soon for Ghost Stick.
10 armor instead of 35 attack speed.
On
I
who?
Like that. On Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, I guess against the Terrorblade and Ursa Warrior. Fair enough. Yeah. He's got plenty of attack speed between his other items. Midas, Shadowblade, as well as that Orchid.
I think it's a good choice, like doubles his armor, more so.
Empire are the ones pressuring this tier 2 mid lane. Again, just trying to reclaim some of this map control that VP keeps shoving down mid. Arc Warden. With his clone out. Tier 2 very easily falls.
If Dire win a fight though, the Radiant are just gonna storm right back too. Like, cooldowns, not of concern whatsoever to the Radiant. You know, Stack Storm is the biggest one, it's 80. And you compare that to the Dire side, we're working at 140 Metamorphosis, and then 165 on the Golems.
Chappie makes a quick escape, and they smoke up. This is a really nifty smoke. If they can run down mid lane and find someone, or even towards these Dire jungle camps where VP are actually standing near the shrine, finding a pick is good, but they're in a similar position that VP were in before. Bot lane, mid lane, pushed in across the river, finding a kill. Doesn't really net you anything objective-wise. You know, they'd love a tier 2, they'd love a tier 3. And finding one, proving to be difficult. Empire just moved back into their base.
Oh, the illusion just killed that trap. I think they saw it come out of the smoke too.
Oh, then a DD Terrorblade. Roshan takes another 2 minutes to come back up. What is it? Yeah, exactly 2 minutes. TB illusions are tanky. They are difficult to kill, and once he's got their metamorphosis up, they'll look to take a fight. FN might have gone too far forward, but he blinks away very quick. There's a glimpse back on the Batrider. Static Storm down onto the TB. Okay, he pops his BKB, and Nekroshka drops with the rock now onto FN's head. He's stunned up, he's bashed. His BKB will allow him to run away from no one, though the lasso is now catching on to the Nature's Prophet. Ramsey's with his double damage rune is running rampant through the ranks of Team Empire.
FN, I think he gets away here, but I mean, that was cheesy used to make sure he survives, but that is a win here for VP and 870 gold. You have Terrorblade, a buyback on Ogre.
You have Metamorphosis Manta style, and you have no one still holding onto his BKB.
Oh, look at FN though, he's going tough.
Oh, hello. With his Desolator, he's putting a bit of damage onto this tier 3, it looks like, and VP fully retreat. If they can catch FN, the first hit bash, okie dokie, no one, that's fair enough. I expected that, of course I did, but the blink available, FN's just going to be able to jump TP. Okay. Never mind.
Nice play by FN.
The battle for the golem.
Nothing is lost.
King R gets 150 gold. Lovely, lovely.
Congratulations. Stepping towards his Aghanim Scepter, but that little essentially distraction tactic by FN has drawn VP way back to their base. They kind of lose that control over the river area, and Empire can push out a little bit here and try and hold on to that Rosh footing. And who has buybacks? Because that's going to be important for this fight. We have a Nature's Prophet buyback, a TB buyback, and a Disruptor buyback. I think a lot of this game is going to be looking in towards this Rosh, this Cheese, and Aegis. What are we missing? We don't have golems for another 70 seconds, and you know they're timing that on the Radiant. We've seen the calls.
Lil was even trying to flap his wings and fly with that new Hunter in the Night active ability to get over the Rosh Pit wall. Roshan is alive. VP are spreading away.
How fast is Chappie to kill this Bloodlusted?
again, VP looks like they're dodging this, but I think they've realized that they have to go back in. The Observer Ward up on the high ground did spot.
Can't, Roshan can't hit you. What is this hero?
Yeah. What do you do when Roshan dies instantly like that? Aegis, Ghost Stick, Cheese goes the way of someone else as well, but Upheaval slows them down. The blink in, Pasha catches one, but the stamp score dropped. All the damage output from Empire, look at them go! Ramzes holds onto the Sunder though. This BKB Terrorblade from the high ground brings down the pain, but FN, he's got the Death Slayer to damage, he's got the Melt Strike as well, and Ramzes stunned up and chained into death! Ghost Stick on the front lines, Bloodlusted up with a glimpse back, sending no one to safety apparently. But TA chases down with the traps, and a TB forward from Ghost Stick's Nexus Prophet will secure yet another kill for Team Empire. Virtus Pro in a lot of trouble right now, Trent. 16,000 net worth lead, but is that one big team fight with Roshan, Aegis, Cheese, and what, a 3,100 net worth swing going the way of Empire? They're breaking high ground, they're taking tier 3s, they're looking for kills deep in behind them.
Die back.
Oh, Solo, see ya, buddy, and with this TB. Oh, Ramzes, where's your Sunder? There it is. Gets onto Meposhka. The stun's not there in time, but they've got the Sprout. He's caught in. He's got no Quelling Blade. FN jumps to the front lines, and with the damage output good enough to kill him, it's GG. Game number 3 of this best of 3 goes the way of Empire, and they secure the series with a Chappie Arc Warden.
Beautifully picked. Very well played from Team Empire. I have this, man, considering game 1, this was looking like it was just going to be a total blowout, wasn't it? You know?
Yeah.
You're talking about how it was like, it looked like totally different tiers of Dota this morning when it was Empire versus Nip. They just ran all over them in very convincing fashion. And then game 1 for VP, it looked like just that next level where they were just going to destroy Empire. And I had, you know, not too much hope. We know they're a good team though, but...
I mean, Empire's going to be going and having a long talk with their manager and saying, yes. Hey, hang on a second. I believe we deserve to be undropped from the major registration list. It wasn't really fair, you know. Maybe a few crocodile tears will be drawn, or I don't know, a few punches. Because that was good. That was really good from Team Empire. 21-15, best of 3 win. Up against Virtus Pro, arguably the strongest team in the CIS region.
And one of the strongest in the world.
Exactly.
They're up there. Man, great day by Empire. Long day, too. They just had to play 5 games. And they won 4 out of 5. Feeling pretty good, I would say.
And that will conclude our day as well, Trent.
Shout out to Disruptor, winning 4 out of 4.
Shout out to Disruptor.
What a hero today.
Very, very strong. So, that means Empire face up against Team Secret tomorrow at 5 p.m.
That sounds pretty hype.
It also means that VP face against Pro Dota tomorrow at 2 p.m. Two more best of threes coming at you tomorrow. EST on this very channel from myself and Trent. Hopefully, we'll have as much fun as we did today. And hopefully, Trent will get to read the patch notes before our series and not mid-series, which happened in the Empire versus NIP series.
Gotta do what you gotta do, guys.
Oh, that was a lot of fun. That was a lot of fun. Well, congrats to Empire. They got themselves up to the winners' match final. They are one series away from the grand final of Mr. Cat. The Mr. Cat EU Invitational. Trent, do you want to tell us who Mr. Cat is yet?
Never.
Oh, I thought they'd taken you there for a second. I thought the cat burglars had come in and nabbed you.
He's a mysterious dude. I know he loves Chinese betters, though. So.
And cardboard boxes.
Go China.
Empty cardboard boxes. Very, very good. On that, I am very tired, and I'm very, very hungry.
Trent, good night, Euros.
I think it's time for dinner. It's 9 p.m. in Europe. It's time to go and eat some food. I'll see you guys tomorrow. I'm going to play some ads. Please watch them. Like that's ever going to happen.